You guys have gotten trained up quick on this. I've never, I'm
well,
pretty impressed.
This is my first time.
No?
Because I haven't had to do any of the rooms.
Oh, you haven't?
Yeah.
No. I think it looks
well,
good,
you
eh?
You can introduce yourself.
Oh, I'm sorry. Do you want to
no,
do that?
No,
I've had.
You can go ahead.
Okay. Thank you for hosting it and helping out. All right, it's 5 o'clock somewhere, so that's why I'm double fisting with two pieces of electronics here and just having a party of a time. Hey everybody, my name is Mitch Dumke. It is good to be here, final hour, and then you're probably going to be sitting in the car for some amount of time, driving for a bit, so either take your cat nap now or take it in the car, but hopefully we can have a good conversation. The first thing to get off my chest is that this is not actually about regenerative agriculture. This is going to be a vulnerability seminar. This is pretty important. We're gonna be talking about our feelings a lot today. Not really. But I'll choose to be a little vulnerable myself here. We're recently, this shows a little bit about my credentials. I'm more proud of my credentials of my partner probably than I am of my own credentials, only because the last year of our first year of running a regenerative agriculture operation, and I have no background in agriculture. I'm passionate about gardening, and I've been involved in a garden community, but in terms of managing with livestock or being in the field, it's been a new learning curve. And so just want to be able to share a little more about what we've learned here. So here's a little fact about me. Hi, my name is Mitch Dumke, and I do not like country music. Just because I decided to work in the country doesn't mean I have to like country music. But just like my 5-year-old daughter, every time my wife makes broccoli, what do I tell my wife? What do I tell my daughter? You got to try it. And so my daughter tries the broccoli, and every once in a while, no matter for some reason, how it's cooked or whatever else, she finds a little bit of health, a little bit of wisdom in that broccoli. And so I give myself the benefit of the doubt to think that every time I hear country music, I might get a little bit of a nugget of wisdom out of there. So here's a little story. I was trying to get some new clothing at the good old Cow Ranch store. You can tell I'm pretty happy about it. I'm not a shopper. When you're 6'2 and lean like me, shopping isn't fun. I'm 6'6. Sorry, not 6'2. I'm taller than 6'2. Plus, I got my high heels on. So I'm at the Cow Ranch store. They're not playing heavy metal there. And they, of course, are playing country music. Anyone know who this fine gentleman is? Anyone know? I didn't. I would not have him unless I Googled it. Luke Bryan. And Jason Day.
Watch their pencil marks in the grass in the yard. All grow up, cause the truth about it is
jam.
It all goes by real quick. You can buy happiness, but you can buy dirt.
Right. Say we can buy dirt. That's the name of this song, buy dirt.
Buy dirt.
Now listen to this line.
Thank the good Lord for it, cause he ain't making any more of it.
Now right there, that's like a mic drop moment. That's what they call that. The good Lord ain't making any more of it. And I thought that was a pretty fascinating statement. To recognize maybe who might have made it, and that no more are being made of it. And that this country singer is already acknowledging that we're calling it dirt when someone's buying dirt. And we've seen a lot of interesting things going on over the last year or two as it relates to dirt being bought. Because people are honestly just looking at it as dirt, probably more for development, honestly, than for agriculture. And so it was kind of a sobering moment to think that all we see in the landscape is we see dirt and not soil. And to think that this song is saying the good Lord made dirt is pretty offensive to think about the creation that we live on and that it was actually soil first. And it's been on our hands, in my opinion, that we've turned it into dirt. So the word regenerative is about rebuilding and improving. It's a buzzword, but in its whole, it's about rebuilding. And so that's where Three Springs operates out of, is a principle of working with nature to produce healthy soil, healthy meat, and a healthy community. And so our primary focus is ecological outcomes and then economic. Because in our model, we know we aren't making money up front, but we believe that the regenerative agriculture can be a way towards profitable farming and ranching. Now we have some benefits. I don't have 100 years of baggage or machinery or practices that have maybe stuck me in my way. Sometimes I wish I had a whole lot more education and in the field experience here, but we're running, you know, three partners, three different families. We've been fortunate to get to know each other over different periods of time. We have different backgrounds. I've been in tech for 10 years. No, I did not make the company. No, I did not make it for billions. And no, I'm not retiring anytime soon. My wife definitely asks me when this venture will make money. And so we're looking into that. So I think I got in the right business. I think leaving tech and going into ranching was the right economical decision. No, that's right. But I'll tell you, from my context, and I come from probably some privilege in saying this, having had a stable income over the last 10 years, I don't feel like our ecology has 10 years to wait. That's how I feel. And so that's why I decided to dedicate more of my life to understanding these practices and dedicating myself to this Camas Valley that I find beautiful and want to keep open. And the last thing I want someone to call our Camas Valley is dirt. So that's a little bit of context where we come from. Cow-calf pair operation, and we did some pastured poultry this last year. You had a chance to maybe eat some of that chicken the other night, I think. Chandler did too. So getting started, we really came from nothing. So last May, we barely had a lease agreement in place. Luckily, my partner posted on Facebook, of all things, and said, "Hey, I want to try this regenerative agriculture." And someone said, "Cool, you can do it on my land." So we have a 40-acre lease for free for 5 years. That's a tricky lease when it's free. You don't have a lot of leverage because they say we can cancel it at any time. It's like, why do we even call it a lease? But it does give us some security, and we're trying to help them be committed to the ecology and improvements. But heck, they could turn it into a fishing pond if they want. We do have water. That's why we're called Three Springs, not just because we're three handsome gentlemen. We also found out there's two other springs on the property. So we'll figure that out. We do have fencing. We had good perimeter fencing that was already in place. We were fortunate with that. And then we can talk about how we do our internal fencing. We kind of had cows. It was an interesting start for us because we had a guy with some belted Galloways. He said he'd sell us 6 cow-calf pair at the beginning of the season. He fed them over the winter for us. We went out in the early spring to go look at those cows. We could only find 3 of the calves. And he's on a 2-acre corral. And we said, "Where are those other calves?" "Oh, they're there." We walked out there and we found one dried up, and he hadn't really taken very good care of them. And you know, one of these cows had clear hip dysplasia, and we said, "Is this how we want to start our herd?" So we had to make the decision and cut our herd in half, and we bought 3 pair from someone else down the road, someone who we trusted. He's never had to really assist in the calving process. We wanted to start with some reasonable good genetics, but that was a tricky, interesting start for us. And then we have skills, because we've watched a lot of YouTube videos. That's about all the skills we had. So, you know, first year operations, how do we kind of build up that skill over time is with our people in our community. And of course, any good company or business or operation needs a theme or a slogan. Ours is a slogan probably across all agriculture, which is "We'll figure it out." And that's about how every day looked for us as we were trying to get through this venture. And we're still figuring it out. I'd love your thoughts, your questions as we go through this. Please interrupt me. We're a small group. We're a little loose after having too much Coca-Cola. So all of that I just shared with you really represents one of the first principles of regenerative agriculture, which is know your context. You've probably seen this in other slides. Gabe Brown says it best when he says, there's a reason that bananas aren't grown in North Dakota, and that's context. And there's other types of context too, beyond ecological. Our ecological context also includes that this land that we inherited has been overgrazed for 80 years. That's important to understand. It hasn't really been tilled up, but it's definitely compact. Social context really talks about the people you need to work with and how that affects your relationships. It could be with a spouse. It could be just with your neighbors. And financial is about money. That's why we got into this business. Just kidding. But we do really have goals to understand how we get there. One way to think about context is precipitation, both water that comes down on the ground from snow or water or rain, but also where is our water access? That's the first thing someone always asks us when we say we want to do a ranch. They say, what about your water? Especially when we do regenerative, we're moving our cattle every day. Where's your water? Went on a learning tour. So this was interesting. We went and visited like 5 different ranches to understand what was going on in Virginia, I worked with Understanding Ag. I was a student there in Alabama for 3 days. That was a humbling, weird experience. I traded in my laptop the month before I quit my job, and I went out and I just traded in for some new work boots and was pretty fresh on a hayride with 60 other ranchers. And they all told me the same thing. I honestly heard it from everyone. When I told them I was brand new to this industry, they said, "You are so lucky." Why would they say that? Why would they say, "I'm lucky having been brand new to this"? No. What? No preconceived ideas. That's exactly, no baggage. And you know, I can see that. I can see that context is important. So that's a little bit of what happened for me. I felt motivated and inspired by it, but I still felt pretty intimidated. And then being on the same page, you know, as a multi-family operation, how do we stay on the same page? And my partners still have day jobs. And I'm getting creative with other ways for making income in the short term. But we meet up every Wednesday night. We do a call for about an hour and a half to try to stay on the same page. We talk about our priorities. We try to map out how we're making money and where that money might happen, and planning out for the year. But also, while you're on the same page as your community, just like all of us here today, we came together not because we're all exactly the same, but we do have some commonality, and it's soil health. And so do you have similar shared passions and interests with your community? So I wanted to talk just observations from our first year and how that connects into what Utah needs, why regenerative could benefit Utah. That was a long, we've talked about it a lot. We've been in a lot of sessions already. We've all heard people talk about the heat, and we were no different. We didn't get our cattle and our chickens until the end of June, or at least out on the field. But when it was hot, this is a view of 120 years of heat in Utah. This is from the ICS. They do a great report about the state of Utah. And this shows the number of very cold nights below zero and very warm nights above 75 over the last 120 years. You start to see some trends. Not getting as often as cold, and definitely staying warmer at night. And there's a lot of implications because of that, and I guarantee you it's not just because we're driving more and we have more cars on the road. Some would argue you could purely go that it's desertification, but that's a different conversation. What did that mean for our context, for our fields? Well, we like to get out on the field with one of these. Nowadays, these are just for checking if you have a microchip in your head from your vaccine. I'm just kidding. But it's actually meant for testing temperature of the surface, not usually for skin. But this is Ryobi from Home Depot. I'm not sponsored by them. Yeah, I mean, it's like $15. But if you haven't, I really encourage you to take this out to the field with you. It's fun to kind of learn what's going on in the field and the temperatures. So we're going to play a little game here. This is participation points time. What's the temperature of that first gun? Here's the context. You can see July 12th. High 97 or midday, so it was low 90s at that point, ambient temperature. And I'm just shooting the temperature of bare surface soil. No plant life. Call it dirt. 112? What do you think? I'm going to give you this hat if you say it, because you said part. Yeah, give me a number. 100? Okay. You're eyeing it after. I didn't want it. Any other ideas? 122 degrees. That's definitely not the hottest day we had. And it's not even the hottest time of day. So the next scan here is about probably the density of the grass. I couldn't say the density is at least 70%. Pretty thick forage, about 14 inches high. So that's got a system going. How hot do you think that was, just scanning the top surface of the grass? Okay, 87, we'll take it. Let's see what happens. 90 degrees. Didn't really matter about the answer, but if you want a hat, there you go. We gotta get rid of these things. And then the last one. This is pulling away the grass and scanning right at the soil surface. 98. 79 degrees. So, same place, right next to each other, within 5 feet of each other. Look at that temperature swing we're seeing. And you'll see that swing more.
If you went to the highest part of Hida that day, you probably saw the root system probably get maybe up to 85, maybe. And that top surface easily can get above 130 degrees. So what's the implications? Well, at 70 degrees, your moisture can be used 100% for plant growth and soil systems. We often forget that soils are a subaquatic environment. They need water to be able to function. At 100, you're only 15%. It's pretty easy to get to 100-degree temperature on the surface pretty quick. You go scan any kind of stubble, harvested area. I mean, we've seen the themes across different presentations about surface coverage. This kind of talks about it in the context of temperature and why that's important. And your DOA when you start getting above 110, 115. I love this quote I got from Paul Hawken. He wrote a book called Regeneration, another one called Drawdown. But it summarizes to me so much of our agricultural system, or the, frankly, to feel empowered about our opportunity to help influence this thing that is called our earth and the temperature around it. Because we are in the Camas Valley, to give a little deeper context, we're 15 minutes away from Park City. Park City likes their snow. Park City likes their food. Park City likes their development. I don't want their development. They can keep it. We got this thing called the large water cycle. We think about all our water sometimes coming from the ocean. And I'm from Salt Lake, and so I think about it coming from the lake effect occasionally, and that's kind of a different thing, but it is representative of a different system called like the small water cycle, which is that as plants are breathing out, they put up small bacteria into the atmosphere that helps accumulate water back into the clouds. That's a healthy system. I leave Salt Lake sometimes. The temperature in Salt Lake and Camas can be almost the same temperature during the day, but at night it drops by 20 degrees. I'm sure you've seen something similar. You have to go out in your fields in the night, and it feels a whole lot colder than you thought. That is transport evaporation, the small water cycle. About 50% of our water can come from that small water cycle. So when Park City says they like their snow so much, then they better like their open space that allows for the transport evaporation to be able to continue to repopulate the moisture that's occurring. So that's a little bit of our context and how we think about people being motivated to keep that space open. If it's not open, you start creating desertification with things getting too hot and not recovering. Clouds can accumulate moisture still, but if it's too hot, it's like trying to bring a balloon into a hairdryer. It's just going to keep pushing it away, so those clouds aren't going to drop their moisture where it's hot. That is a problem with your water cycle. So the principle is keeping your ground covered. This is a photo of some of our pasture at the end of September. You think something might be growing, possibly, but it's cold enough at 6,500 feet elevation that you drive by everyone else's fields if they already cut their last hay, which they have. It's just stubble and it's sitting there. But we have this nice blanket that's reading bedtime stories at night and helping them be able to have growth because it's an insulated layer so that the temperatures are not as extreme, both in it's cold and it's warm, and so we can have a place for further germination and growth. This is a piece of our land. This is just taken in November after we placed a little bell here. This bell was strategically placed for us to be able to graze the cattle on because we observed where we needed to see some improvement. Can you see anything else going on in the picture? You see all those little lines? They're kind of hard to see, but that's our, we did a no-till on there, so we'll talk more about that. But this is our cattle grazing right now. We leave the hay out there, and it's going to be able to create that surface coverage. Is it the perfect kind of surface? No, but it can create a real jump start in the system, especially since we put cover crop seeds underneath it. We have active seeds, and the thing is we always have a seed bank, and I didn't know what a seed bank was. But in Alabama, where I did some training with the Soil Health Academy, they had taken a field that had been in 80 years of crop rotation between soy, wheat, and corn, and in 4 years' time of them doing this practice without any additional seeding, they had counted over 120 species of grasses, legumes, forbs, just by purely letting the soil and the seeds express themselves. And so you got to be surprised and expect the seed bank to kind of surprise us a little bit. This is another type of shade. You guys ever seen this? You ever heard one of these? They told us we were the first one to ship one to Utah. I don't know if that's a good thing or not, but they're like, you're crazy enough to buy one of these. It's called a shade haven. And we use it actually not to cover the ground so much as to create shade for our cattle in peak heat, really throughout the whole season. There's a lot of other benefits too. You can create more herd effect and more high density grazing. We'll put this thing over a thing of thistle, and they'll graze over and stomp it. Depending on the type of thistle, that's beneficial, but it at least helps it set back the succession on those thistles so that other plants can come through. So, keeping living roots in the ground as long as possible, we've talked quite a bit about that today. I think in Jill's presentation, really talked about the science of the soil. But as you have diversity in that root system as well, you know, a plant is really only going to be in its fast growth cycle for about 28 days, and then it starts to really fall off. So how do we make sure there's something every 28 days that's keeping that soil system really active, and also keeping plant species that are very active, high nutrient value for the animals? And that's just simply by putting in more diversity so you have a consistent, constant flow. There's a video I want to show you here. This is us doing a core sample out of our soil. McKinley's certified as a lab tech with Soil Food Web and accredited professional at the Savory Institute. And he's observing this 6 inches of soil. What you see in the top couple inches is enough roots that it's less compact. You can't really hear him. I'll just narrate over it because it would be hard to hear, but it's too compact on the bottom. And then about 2 or 3 inches of roots getting down there before it starts to get hammered. And that's not surprising for one, flood irrigation, and two, overgrazing year over year. That's why we're getting some cover crops in there. We're trying to get some diversity and getting some more rest so those roots can get deeper. This is a simple fact. Jimmy talked a lot about my neighbor had this much rain or this neighbor had that much rain. When you have more organic matter in it, that's your sponge. Your organic matter is what keeps the water in the soil. So as you improve organic matter for every 1%, you're just holding 25,000 gallons of water. How do you get organic matter? A lot of different ways. The easiest way is where animal impact comes into play. We'll talk about that. But at a high level, when grass gets eaten, its roots freak out. The plant freaks out and it sheds some of its roots. That's organic matter going into the soil. So that's where that animal impact is really beneficial. Now, a little bit of learning I feel like I received over the last 12 months, 8 months, is the understanding that when I think about the food chain, that carrot I ate is not the end of the food chain. There is a violent world underneath the soil that's happening. I've always said we know more about deep space and the deep sea than we know about what's deep under our feet. And so we need to be able to understand who's eating who. That bird eating that arthropod is also going to be eating that nematode who ate the protozoa, who ate the bacteria. And I never thought about that before. Because when they give kids a seed in first grade and say, go grow it in a Ziploc bag, they just say it needs water, sun, and dirt. Or soil, if they're, you know, generous. But they don't talk about everything else. Fungal dump. You know, I would love my kid in first grade to raise a hand and say, what's the fungal bacterial ratio in the soil you're giving me? So we got to educate our kids a little more. Principle we heard a lot about as well is no-till and till with the damage of tilling. You know, we are losing our topsoil at an accelerated rate. Some estimates say that we have 60 more harvests left with our topsoil before we're out of it. That's a sobering thought. But we also know that no-till can be beneficial in helping reduce the amount of impact. When we talk about no-till is just continuing to reset any of the soil cycle. Any of the soil system that we have going on. This is what a no-till drill looks like in operation. Those front discs are cutting a little slice. Then there's an opener to spread open a little bit. Drops the seed in. And then on the back side, you see these last little wheels. They're just closing the soil back on to get that seed to soil contact. That's how that operation works. And we've got a lot of seeds in atop there. We have a 7-way cover crop mix that we use. It's a cool season cover crop. Some might put their cool season seeds in the early spring. We chose to do ours the end of October, partly because we had really good rains in October, about 6 inches of rain in a week. Things dried out enough. We were worried about snow coming, and so we were able to till in some nice soft soil. So it'll be dormant all season. We've had enough moisture. We need more of it. We'll just be able to see what happens. Like I said, we'll figure it out. I really don't know if that was the right call or not. We don't know if we did the right seeds, but the seeds we did do were high nitrogen fixing seeds. We have two different types of vetch, two different types of pea that are all legumes. We also did triticale, clover, and then the one I'll always forget. The one that got away. This is Lloyd Martian, who's helping us out here. He's our representative of the Conservation District, and he's who we bought our cattle from. But we know that no-till can reduce erosion heavily, both in rain and water. In water and wind erosion. This is another way to think about it, though, too. When it comes to data, so you don't have to trust my word, you can trust the scientists. This experiment, they gridded out a huge pasture. And they said, hey, for this pasture, we're going to both throw in a ton of different types of seeds based on the number of seeds, but also functional diversity. So I say a forb or a legume or a grass or maybe more woody species. They were breaking that out into different things. And you can see that as you get around that curve around like 8 to 10 plants, you start to get diminishing returns, but there's a steep returns all the way up to 5 when you add more diversity into your plant, into your pasture. And then similar here, as you get to that 2 to 3, more diversity in the functional groups, you see that same increase in biomass. In ranching, we care about the biomass because that's our forage. So that's the principle of diversity and dynamics. There's a great quote by Masanobu Fukuoka. He wrote a book called One Straw Revolution. An object seen in isolation from the whole is not the real thing. And in science, we often go to a state of reductionism to break things down into its component parts. But as I heard in another presentation, I liked it, just saying, you can say the steering wheel is really cool, but it doesn't mean much unless you know what's going on with the engine and the wheels and you have a whole car to think about. And so you got to respect the individual thing, honor it, but you have to understand its role in the larger system. So those are some of our observations as we're just looking at the land. We got all this grass, we have 40 acres, well, we got to do something with it. And one of our other sayings we had probably too much throughout the year was, we need more cows. And that was a tricky thing, because what does it mean we have more cows? Why wouldn't we want more cows? More headache? What's that? Wintering. Yeah. We had already seen the drought start to kick in because it was June. We didn't get those cows until June 28th. And we knew we were in a hurt for hay to winter. And so we decided to go small, have a lower stock density. And overall, we were comfortable with that decision, but we wish we could have foraged longer in the winter, into winter, if we had been able to graze through everything once or twice, to have a little later stimulated growth, to have something in its active life cycle of growing, say, in October, especially as we had a mild start to the winter. So some of the considerations when we were trying to figure out what livestock to use to get rid of this grass were these items. We had a partner who was chomping at the bit. If you've heard of a guy named Joel Salatin in Polyface Farms, he's sort of a real progressive guy with different ranching and farming practices. And he's a real educator. And he talks a lot about the first profitable venture you should do is chickens, meat chickens. So we said, okay, we like the idea of profit. So we bought chickens. And all of a sudden, James said, hey, I bought 150 birds. And we said, okay, we'll figure it out. And so we built this little brooding setup inside of a tin shed in Salt Lake City. And we did that for the month of June, the first 3 weeks of June. That seemed cute and dandy, until the temperatures decided to show up for the month of June. Now, if you're trying to brood a chicken that's pretty young, and you have a 100-degree day, that's okay, but that's a tin shed. That thing got hot fast, so we're putting fans and shade cloth on it and doors and trying to circulate the air so they don't get too hot and have a bunch of chicken nuggets in there. That was our goal, regenerative nuggets. And then, you know, the next week we got to 46 degrees at night. So we have huge temperature swings. That was stressful. By the third week, they get a little more resilient. But then we move them out to these chicken tractors. Y'all ever worked with a chicken tractor or seen something like this in a field? I don't know. You've seen one? Yeah. We don't see too many of them. I know people say they do pastured poultry, but we're getting familiar with it ourselves. But each one of these holds 70 birds. I'll show you a little video here. I'll turn down the volume. I'll just kind of talk over it, but you know, this is the daily chore when it comes to chickens. Do they have feed, and do they have water, and do they have fresh forage, which was half of their feed? So each day, we would drive out or walk out, depends what we were doing. This is a creek that goes, not this, well, this is one of the creeks, but you can see where all the trees are. That's a creek that runs through the middle of our pasture. And so we'd have to go with these 40-gallon or 5-gallon buckets every day, grab water, throw it into the top, and it feeds these birds. We give them fresh feed every day. Half their diet is going to be through forage, grasses, bugs, insects, manure, things like that. The other half is going to be through the grain that we feed them, or whatever feed we have. So we bought our feed from IFA. They have a soy-free, organic, non-GMO, if that's not enough labels for you. But watch what happens is we have these birds and we start to move them. You can kind of see, it looks a little dirty underneath where they are. We added some additional fencing along the side because of predator issues. We had raccoons that weren't getting inside, but we had enough little holes in our flatland that they would just stick their hand underneath, break a leg, break a neck. And then we have this little dolly that McKinley manufactured. But you see that soil? You see the dirt? It looked dirty. That's because those birds are putting down 300 pounds of nitrogen in a single day. They poop 16 times a day. It's a lot of manure. We were a little worried about it, and they're curious. You see their head poking out. We did break a head or neck or two from that. But then watch how they forage. We haven't given them their feed again. They love it. 70 birds, 70, yeah, 75 each. 10 feet by 12 feet, 2 feet high, 3/4 of it covered. Yeah. We are a little concentrated on our numbers. We would probably do less. We've looked at doing a tractor called the Suskovich chicken tractor. Joel Salatin did some experiments between 50 chickens and 100 chickens. And he ran, what number did you get there on the ratio? Did you do it? No, I want to hear it. Yeah. Yep. Yeah. It was. Well, they got less clean beer, right? Yep. Yeah. Yeah, and that dirt, like I said, it's not really dirt. I mean, what they do really well is with those little velociraptor claws is that they rip up all that soil really well. But the concentration was kind of a consideration for us. We're trying to figure out. It felt too tight. At the beginning, it felt fine. But the growth they do in 40 days, they're kind of Frankenstein birds. While we're here, I'll just show you. This is what our simple cattle operation looks like. We use electric fence every day. Obviously, you can see where they're hanging out, and you know why. It's a lot cooler there for them. And we would open up the fence, and they move on their own. But they don't move on their own as well because we have that shade. So usually we would move the shade over first, drive it over the electric fence, and then they would follow the shade. But if we don't have the shade up, they'll just move over to the next paddock every day just fine. So, if you can kind of see from the impact here, does anyone know what this grass is on the perimeter around there? Any ideas what that might be? Arctic sedge, wiregrass. Not a desirable plant for cows. They don't like to eat it. But who did? Those chickens. They got a nice diversity of diet. We found them always with like a little, it looked like they were just a farmer with a little straw in their mouth. Just they had something stuck down in their gullet. But they were eating a lot, and then what grew back was really thick dandelion. We did not see dandelion like that before. But all of a sudden, once we introduced new nutrients into the cycle, some natural fertilizer, we started to see the soil express itself different with different plant life. And these cows are chomping at the bit. They're ready to get in there tomorrow. They're ready. So these chickens served their purpose, and we were grateful for them. After 8.5 weeks, we did a processing day. We had volunteers and other people come up, and we figured out we made an outdoor kitchen underneath this pavilion.
had running water, power. We dispatched him and bled him out over here. Scalded him here, plucked him here, and then processed him. And then let him rest in water. HB 181 is a bill that got passed 4 years ago, I think, Cimbria, something like that. It was a bill that Red Acre Center was involved in, and it was to help ensure that small operations could process up to 1,000 birds without the same kind of state and USDA inspection. And so we operate underneath that. We process those 130 birds, and we can do quite a bit more. We sell those birds for $30 a bird. In more efficient operations, it costs us a lot on processing because of our ice and because of buying like coolers, which is our infrastructure that we don't have to buy again. We want to get down to about $12 per bird on cost. It costs us more like $18, so our profits weren't as good. But you have to do a lot of birds to make it scale and make it, but it is profitable out of the chute, just not extremely profitable until you get more birds going. Sorry, not saying more profitable, just more lucrative. This is a picture of the Camas Valley from aerial view. We operate just on the side here. It's such a beautiful spot. They didn't want to make the rest of the picture look ugly, but you get the idea. If you go this way, you go into Park City. And so this is the highest density right here in Camas Valley. A little bit more in a place called Oakley here. And then this is the Yuna Mountain Range. You have high elevation mountain range. And so what is going on, guys? Oh, there we go. So what I wanted to show this for is really thinking about how we envision what Three Springs can do for the future. And we don't want to control the world. We don't want to manage the world in their pastures. But we do believe that in these practices, we can prove that this can stay open. And this just isn't historical legacy of our roots and our heritage, but it's a viable, important part of our current economy. And sometimes that seems forgotten because we call real estate, we call warehouses highest best use because it can be turned into a storage facility or a new office building. But that's the final crop when you go to building. And this is what helps produce snow. This is what helps this land stay cooler at night. And if we get rid of this air conditioning system, we start to run into more and more problems. This can also allow us to build a healthier environment, a healthier food system. This is a picture of our other herd we manage in Africa. I'm just kidding. We don't have wildebeest in Africa, but they're here. And these wildebeest are roaming and migrating. And they don't look that compact right now, but I guarantee you they are. Why are they compact? That's right. They got that guy creeping on them. And that is an important relationship that sometimes I felt like I underestimated when it came to what type of grazing practices we had. Because as these bison in the Americas and as these wildebeest in Africa are compact, they are grazing tightly, but they're also leaving all their waste behind. And I always tell, I've never seen a toilet in a kitchen. And there's probably good reason for that for a few reasons. And I don't think wildebeest or bison enjoy their toilet in their kitchen either. So they mob together, they mow it down, and they move because they don't want to be in that dirty place anymore and they don't have any more forage. So how do you create that in a cattle environment or any other livestock environment if you want to be able to do that? Well, for us, this is what it would look like. We graze some here, and then the next week, this is in our land. When you do that grazing that day, you kind of get worried that maybe you grazed it a little too much. But over time, you start to see the improvement. And the question is, does it work? This is what a move looks like. This is in Alabama when they're moving a fence. They just opened it up and they started to move on their own. This is a herd of 600. They're actually moving them into a half acre paddock. And they had them there for 40 minutes. And by the end of that 40 minutes, it looked like a bog. It just looked totally annihilated. But a lot of that bog was actually them mowing it and then leaving a lot of manure. I guarantee you we couldn't find one cow pie in there because they were so tightly compacted, they stirred it all up for us, and that was what was left. There's a few sayings. One might be take half, leave half. Another one might be take a third, leave a third, lay a third. And laying a third down allows that grass to make contact back with the soil, start to break down into more organic matter as well. In the Chihuahuan Desert, this is an impact you can see over six years. They move their animals 8 times a day, and they've been able to quadruple their stock density in this time. Now, what they've been able to do is create a lot of water infrastructure so that they can actually get these cattle water. Now, do the cattle need water at eight of those every paddock every day? They can alternate. They can go without water for a couple hours, depends on the heat and everything else. And so that's some of the benefit of being able to move them, is you don't need water all the time, but you can still impact certain parts of the land that might otherwise be off limits because of water access. Another part of grazing we had talked about in another session was just this concept of what is overgrazing. And overgrazing is not allowing a plant to be able to recover. So in our experience, as we go and look at our soil system and our plants, the way I always explain it is like this. You got plants above, you got roots below. I'm doing a little puppet slideshow here, or a puppet shadow. Shadow puppet, there it is. So a cow chomps it down, a sheep, some kind of ruminant or grazing animal. Probably not a horse, but you can do this with horses. And when it gets eaten down, the roots just freak out. They shed their roots, and you're already starting to add organic matter back to the soil. Well, then what that plant's going to do is start to put all of its energy, because it shed its roots, it needs to get more soil, get more nutrients, and photosynthesize, and it's going to start growing again. That growth system is carbon sequestration. I really don't think we need to go pay millions and billions of dollars for machines to suck carbon out of the atmosphere and put it back in the ground. We have this great natural system right now that does it. It's just called plant life and photosynthesis. But if you don't allow that plant to fully recover, these roots are still compromised, it gets chomped again, and just like up there, it's not going to be able to withstand drought, heat, and other things to be able to access all the water it needs and other nutrients. When you're doing these daily moves, the question is, how much do you give them? I said take half, leave half. That's what forage left is in this equation. Y'all ever seen a forage stick? It's kind of a fun little thing. I didn't know what it was all about. It looked like a old human walking stick. That's what it looks like in the ground. It was kind of hard to see, but do you see it there? So the question is what percent visibility is it in there? How dense is that? What would you call it? Is it 100% coverage? No, because you can still see it. Well, I'm going to say 80, but usually you probably should go down 1 to 70%. It's always worth just kind of assuming you're a little less confident than you are. What gets really interesting is you get below 60, 50, 40. Sometimes there's a lot of bare spots. It's so important to keep looking down, because if you estimate your forage density looking across, you're always going to feel a lot more confident. That stick is a really good gut check. I think that's the most important thing it does me. It has numbers, it measures and all that stuff, but it makes me have to be honest with how much I really can or can't see of it, because otherwise I just do dumb things and guess by looking out. Then you take the height, and then collectively when you get that height, we average it out about 28 inches, and you plug it into the math, assuming you want to leave 50% of that. We only have 6 cows at 2,800 pounds. 2,800 pounds is how much forage we had. We took that number. Oh, I moved the numbers around. I'm sorry. I got to fix that. That's why it's confusing. But we took how much cattle we have and knew they needed 3.5% of their weight every day, and we have a really tight paddock. That's why I said we have a saying around our little ranch, which is we need more cows. And we're working on that. But the animal impact in our experience and in our context is it's important to build up the urban-rural relationship and understand the connection between the two systems, and they're not at odds with each other. So for us, we've gone to a community foundation, and actually we just received a grant for 3 years for $75,000, And that grant is going to fund the study of our soil as well as three other ranches with USU and Matt Yost up there. And they're going to study and monitor our soil for its ecological improvement. We think hopefully improvement, hopefully not negatively impacting it. But to understand what's going on in the soil. And with that, we actually are going to talk about, in that community, carbon sequestration and global warming is a big issue because snowpack, they want their snow. And so we're actually evaluating what it would look like if we created a carbon credit market based on our practices in our ranching. You see some of this more in the East with, there's different companies, one called Indigo Ag, another one called Nuvi, and essentially they will pay ranchers or they'll pay farmers to do cover crops or different things that prove that they're sequestering carbon. In our context, we're not planting things like that. We're doing grazing. But we're saying, hey, when we keep those live plant systems going in the ground, we're sequestering carbon. And the estimates from a few different studies conservatively show that 1.3 tons. And so the going market is actually increasing right now to more about $20 an acre. Why does that matter? Well, every dollar matters. And when it comes to a rural valley like Camas Valley, and you have pressure from Park City where the billionaires are pushing out the millionaires, and these millionaires are buying up 100-acre swaths at a time, it's important for them to understand that they can actually be part of the saving the earth movement a lot of times, and that they can be sequestering carbon. That's one model. What's more important to me is that those ranchers and families and farmers who have been in that valley for over a century, stay connected to the land, and that their kids don't see a business in the red and they can see a business in the black. And look, our operation isn't in the black right now. This is how much money we made at the bottom off our chickens this year on 130 birds. We gave some discounts to a certain nonprofit, but you know, we had a lot of expenses. This big one was the Shade Haven. It's $13,000. Did we need to buy that? No, but my partner really liked it, and he likes shiny things. But if we got rid of that cattle asset, we'd be about $16,000 in the hole this year. And you know, our biggest expense is going to be how our hay works, just like everyone else, and how much cattle are going to cost for us to grow our herd. And we're trying to figure out creative ways to make that happen. Whether we borrow cattle, we do custom grazing essentially for a little bit, or we do stalkers where we just buy them in the spring and sell them in the fall, we don't know. But we want to be able to build a meat product that has the nutrient density from grazing diverse grass species. It's not just about healing the land for us, it's about healing humans through their diet. The nutrient density of an 8-ounce piece of beef from a regenerative cow can have almost twice the nutrient density as a commodity cow. Now, why does that matter? You actually get more full and you have more available nutrients. And so you actually need to eat less of it, or you're more full from it. I still like my 20-ounce T-bone from Outback. My dad used to buy me when I went to church, but you know, it's not the most nutrient-dense thing, I'm pretty sure. So the six principles, those are them in terms of how we've learned them. The real benefit to Utah is these different types of elements. And I guess coming back to from the beginning of this conversation and this vulnerability for me, thanks for letting me share a little bit about it and our journey, is, you know, asking the question to each of you, are you going to listen to country on your drive home? I'm just kidding. No, but really, like, think about the broccoli. Think about the things that maybe you are hesitant to try, or you've tried once, but you probably should try again and see if this time it works, or just try something a little different and find the nugget and the goodness in it. And, you know, back to the song, from my perspective, is, are we in the business of buying dirt, or are we in the business of building soil? And I hope we're not in the business of selling dirt. You know, I think we're in a place where ranchers and farmers deserve to be compensated better for their practices and for the nutrients that they deliver to their livestock as well as to individuals. So on that note, take questions and just thank you for your time. Appreciate it. I'll take your temperature too if you want. Just kidding. Yeah. Yeah. Why go with cattle? That's a great question. My partner McKinley grew up on a 700 acre ranch with 100 cattle. So I think it was the little bit of a devil we knew. He didn't really run them intensely himself. Every animal has sort of their different value. And for us, that cow grazes differently. And, you know, we're never going to be able to have chickens go through 5,000 pound acres of land and graze it down. Maybe we would bush hog it or do something else to mow it up. But for us to be able to keep that plant growing in its cycle, we believe you need some kind of ruminant, either a sheep. We could have done sheep or a cow. The chickens, like I said, those 130 birds covered a quarter acre in 40 days. We are considering the idea of, there's these pretty cool schooner operations where essentially it's like a tunnel, a greenhouse on slides, skids, and you just move them every 3 days. I think that is a more interesting way than what we were doing. But you need something stronger than a chicken to be able to mow down the grass and keep the plant in its life cycle. So you can't, a chicken alone won't be able to keep the plant growing, to keep that soil cycle going, from our perspective. It's true. Yeah, and going more to that custom grazing, we can sublease essentially our free land and manage it that way. And we'll probably end up having to do that because we just secured another 150 acres because we didn't have enough already. But that's something we're considering. Yep. 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 It's true. The cow-calf pair thing, the question we have for ourselves is, do we want to get in the genetics game? The reason we'll do a cow-calf operation from our perspective is if we want to build up our own genetics on a cow that can finish well on grass in our high elevation context. And I think the jury's out on that. We're not really sure yet. Yeah, we've talked to a few people here, and we've read about, you know, Akushis or something, a desert mountain grass-fed. So there's different groups that definitely have built up genetics that we don't need to reinvent the wheel. So that's a consideration. I mean, a regenerative piece of beef, we're seeing cows sell for $3,500 to $4,000 for regenerative meat sold direct to customers, direct to consumer. Now you got to create a whole marketing system at some level to figure out how to sell that a bit. And there's some additional overhead. That cow's finishing at 24 to 28 months. You got to hold them over two winters usually. So we're trying to figure out maybe what our winter pasture looks like further south. And maybe we're swapping with someone to do that. Yeah, it's tricky. But that's a pretty decent profit margin over the commodity market. Those are all fair considerations. Any other? For 3 years. It's $25,000 a year. Yeah, and that's about half the price as the Savory Institute. They have it's called EOV, Ecological Outcome Verification. The benefit of that is that they give you a stamp after 3 years or so that you can put on your meat, kind of more certified regenerative. From our experience so far, people are going to be willing to pay for it. We have a social media presence. You can follow us, and we're educational. We're not really TikTok dancing entertainers. We try to be mostly educational, but with some entertainment value. But my one advice I'd say if you get into the marketing world is don't rely on social media. It's a nice place to be, but those algorithms, I think someone called it Facebot earlier. It was funny.
But essentially, those algorithms will decide what people think is important to them. And so even if someone says, oh, I'm going to follow you on Facebook or whatever, that doesn't mean they're ever going to see your stuff. And if you really want people to subscribe and you want to sell direct to customers, you're going to want to get into a newsletter market where they can say, here's my email or here's my phone number. You text me or email me when you're ready with your meat, and then we'll buy it. And that's a much more confident selling system than the whole social media world. Yeah. Just buying the bags, yeah, on those. Yeah, we ended up, when you buy them on the and in pallet, one ton at a time, our feed costs were, I wanted to say it was $20 per 50-pound bag. I'm trying to remember exactly right now. I can't give you that number. What's that? That would be cool. Yeah, something around there. But, you know, I mean, Joel Salatin did say something I think it's important for all of us to remember is I was on a tour with him, and this one woman asked him and said, hey, why don't you give your chickens this perfect idealistic feed? He said, well, I'm not in the business of going out of business. And he said, incrementalism to perfection. He said, let's first solve the problem of too many high density operations where chickens are just being in warehouses and have no real life or nutrition to them anymore. And once we solve that problem, then we can figure out how to feed them better. But let's just incrementalism to perfection and not overdo it too quickly. And I think that's the same story when it comes to fertilizers or no-till. You don't have to do everything all at once. You'll probably crash and burn. Cool. Yeah. Please. Yeah, so our end goal is that in the Camas Valley, as much property is under regenerative management as possible, whether it be us or someone else. Our immediate goal is that we can be a demonstration site for other people to come and see our practices and learn from them and implement them. And we can try other people's practices too. We're not on an ivory tower here. The bigger vision is that we could be a co-op, but this needs to be a community commitment. And we could run a herd together across that whole valley of 20,000 acres. And we could have, I would love to see us have our own kill site there in that valley. And those cows never have to leave that valley until they're packaged, finished good. And that can stay in the local economy as much as possible. Yeah. We do field days. Yeah, we haven't set up our schedule for those this season, but yeah. And, you know, hit us up. We're always there every day. That's the nice part of management intensive grazing is we always have to be there. You can always call and we'd love to show you around. It's fun in the spring and in the summer. A little boring right now. Well, everyone drive safely. Thanks for